to another episode of MSc FinWiz. This week we travel to XLRI in Jamshedpur to find out how aspiring professionals and students are planning their investments.
XLRI Xavier School of Management is an Indian private school for management education based in Jamshedpur, Jharkhand. Established in 1949 as the Xavier Labor Relations Institute, XLRI is acknowledged as India's oldest business management school. Ranked among the top 5 business schools in India, XLRI offers esteemed flagship courses in business management, personnel management, human resource management, global MBA, short-term course in general management, and doctoral fellow programs. Among many other factors, XLRI's mission to offer an enriching learning experience to aspiring managers has been unbeatable and consistent. Focusing on our theme for the series, MSc FinWiz visited XLRI in Jamshedpur to gauge thoughts and notions of the young students on investments and financial planning.
Probably after XLRI and after having secured a substantial amount of capital, I would probably want to invest in certain stocks which will provide me a good return in future.
I would start by investing in real estate because that is one area I think it's going to be like stable for the next few years. So
after all your liabilities like EMIs, loans and all those, how after they are deducted, so the amount that you have left, so that basically is the amount that you would plan to invest. So I would think that as we take more loans and EMIs and we start living on the edge, it starts decreasing the amount that you plan on investing.
If I was to invest with real money, I would look at my risk return profile, and if I am bullish on the market that is currently prevailing in India, I would invest in the equities.
I would probably start off with something that is more fixed, like in fixed deposit, some securities of sorts. Gradually I'd improve upon the risk factor, because that would obviously give me a more better returns.
We have a organization called Student Funding on campus, which publishes reports on what stocks would be best to hold, what to sell and what to buy. So we currently had a student fund report on automobile sector, which says that automobile sector is supposed to grow at a good rate in the coming fiscal quarters. So if I wanted to ask the experts if this analysis is true, and if so, what are the best companies to buy and what are the best companies to sell.
Okay, so warm welcome to students of XLRI Jamshedpur. Okay, we have our expert, Mr. Harshvardhan Roongta, a certified financial planner with Roongta Securities. Now, he's going to tell you how small steps in financial planning can have a big impact in your lives. So, Harsh, if you can start with, why is it important for students at this young age, why is it important for them to think about investments?
Well, Veena, if you look at financial planning, it is said that if you start well, you're half done. You really don't want to go halfway into your plan and then realize there is something amiss and then you start all over again. You wasted a lot of time. So when you talk about investing, when you talk about financial planning, time is really an asset which you need to preserve carefully. If I may share an example with you, okay, which gives you an idea about how time and how power of compounding can actually impact one's corpus that he accumulates over a period of time. Let me share this with you. You are all individuals right now pursuing your education. The moment you complete your education, you're going to be working and you're going to be earning some income for yourself. You really need to know that in case you're going to delay your financial planning, what is the impact that is going to have on you? Let me share an example with you, and we've shared this example on several occasions. The only reason I repeat that with you is that you will get an idea of what I'm going to try and say. Suppose you start a job, you start investing. Okay, the first thing that you do is you pick up 1,000 rupees that you get from your income, which I believe all of you will be able to afford. And suppose you start investing for long term. You say, this is 1,000 rupees I'm not getting in my hand anymore. You invest it, set it aside for a period of say 30 years. If you are investing in an equity asset class and we assume a return that you will get will be around 14% compounded, this 1,000 over a period of 30 years will accumulate to become a corpus of 54 lakhs. In case you decide, okay, now I've just started my job, let me just enjoy myself, I believe, live in the moment, why should I save now, I don't have money to save, okay, that may be your attitude, I will start saving once I get a little more stable into my career. Suppose you wasted 5 years and you started investing 5 years hence from when you should have. So now you have 25 years to invest, right? And we assume the same 14% return that you generate on your corpus, on your investments. The corpus at the end of 25 years as against 30 years. Okay, 30 years was 54 lakhs. The corpus that you will accumulate after 25 years will be 26.5 lakhs. A delay of 5 years is going to set back your corpus by 50%. So that's the power of compounding.
Okay, so we'll start with one of the major assets that I think a lot of the students would know, would be aware of, is equities. So how do you think that they can go about investing in equities, and what is it that they should really know to just begin with if they're beginning with?
Well, see, the first thing, equities is a very important asset class to have in your portfolio. But also remember, equities are an asset class only if you can stay invested for more than 10 years. So in case you have any requirement which is less than 10 years, you should not choose to invest into equities. So the idea is you have to invest into an asset class which beats inflation.
When you start earlier, that time you might not have so much experience and knowledge of financial investments, right? So we might have more risk than what we would eventually have 5 years down the line. So how do you cater to that? That if we invest in a wrong asset or a wrong like subset of that asset, we might end up losing our money. So how to cater to that?
See, well, it's a very good question. I understand that you've already started, you've actually moved to a situation where you have already started imagining that you're investing. So which is a very nice thing. Now you must understand, when you invest, okay, there is something called an asset allocation. You say, suppose you want to invest 10,000 rupees a month. You will obviously not put the entire 10,000 rupees into any one asset class. What I mean when I say asset class, equity is an asset class, debt is an asset class, gold is an asset class, real estate is an asset class. So you're not going to invest everything into one asset class. You need to have a balance, and you need to diversify your investments into different asset classes. Then the second question comes is, as I mentioned, you have to keep in mind your goals. Okay? If you have goals which are only 5 years from now, then 100% of investments can also go into debt. Because you cannot afford to invest into equities, because you need the money only after 5 years.
Okay, but I'm sure that the students also want to know, what are the pitfalls that come in when you invest? I mean, it's easier said than done, but what are the pitfalls that they have to take care of?
See, well, Veena, what I'm more apprehensive and what's scaring me away is that when you get into your job, invariably we've seen a habit with individuals that the money comes in, you worked hard for it, the money that comes in, you tend to spoil yourself. That's the first thing that you do.
So you're talking about the spending patterns.
Absolutely.
So they have to be also careful of how they spend.
Absolutely. In fact, how do you spend is a very important aspect of financial planning. When we talk about financial planning, it does not only mean investing. It also means how prudently you can, execute your expenses. You need to budget. You need to make sure that the investments that you're doing is not causing a burden on your finances. Because if you start investing and you overcommit yourself, and then you realize that your expenses are much more than what you can save to invest, then there is a problem again. So financial planning is a holistic view of your finances, not only your investing. So what I'm more concerned, and I'd like to address that issue right now, is that when you start earning, make sure you do not overspend on any particular luxuries or something that you would want to spoil yourself with.
You're watching NSC FinWiz Season 2. A lot more coming up after the break. Stay tuned. Welcome back. You're watching NSC FinWiz Season 2, and we are at XLRI Jamshedpur. You know, I'm also sure all of them have credit cards, and they're using their credit cards, and how prudently that they should use their credit cards, because they should realize that they're paying a lot of interest in their EMIs.
Well, credit cards are a very effective financial tool if used prudently. Credit card is not a bad word. Usually make out to be, our parents don't like giving us credit cards because they feel that you would start misusing it. Well, partly it is true because we have set those examples for them. However, credit card is the way forward. You have to learn how to have a weapon in your hand and still not use it. So credit card is a weapon, and you really need to know how to use it. Everything is online these days. Okay, and there are good bargains online. So if you're talking about being prudent in spending, if you're getting something which is cheaper online, you would definitely not go and pay more, only to avoid using a credit card. So that's not what we're trying to say. What we're trying to say is, if you're getting a good deal, make sure you've tapped onto the cost of ownership concept, You really convince it needs to be bought and then you execute it. Second element you need to be careful with credit cards is that whatever is your outstanding, make sure you settle it in the billing cycle itself. Do not roll over. The interest costs are huge. It's almost 3% per month. So if in case you're rolling over, the interest that you will be paying is almost 36 to 40%.
Can I make investments which can help me in efficient tax planning as well?
Absolutely, Divya. I'm glad you asked this question. When you make an investment, or rather let me take you down your taxation. When you start earning, I'm reasonably sure when you get a job, you'll be in at least a 20% tax bracket, if not 30%. So you would be having a reasonably good income for yourself. You would need to make investments for saving tax as well. There are certain sections available in the Income Tax Act which actually permit you to invest in specified investments, notified products, and they help you get tax benefits. Now, there are several options available within those in those sections. So Section 80C is one section which helps you save up to 1.5 lakh rupees and gives you tax benefits on that amount. Now, what all are covered in that Section 80C? Mutual funds that we spoke about, equities. You can invest into equities, mutual funds, and save tax. There are ELSS. The schemes are called equity linked saving schemes, the tax saving schemes. You can make investments into them. They will work like an equity fund. The only catch being that there is a lock-in of 3 years for those investments. You can invest into insurance policies. You can invest into post office deposits. There are national savings certificates that you can invest. There are 5 years bank fixed deposits. So yes, you can align all your goals and invest into products which fit into a risk profile, at the same time give you tax benefits. So yes, when you invest, you must take care of tax benefits and the advantages that come, you can save a lot of tax, which is definitely welcome.
As you suggested that for a new investor, it would be advisable to invest in an equity market. Is there any sector specific norms, like I should invest in automobile sector, any other sector which can dominance factor on it, or there should be a ready reckoner for a new investor that which industry or which particular company that person can choose?
Basically, she's saying when you start out for the first time to invest in equities, how do you really start out?
Well, just a small clarification. I'm saying when you start new, equity is one of the asset classes that you should be investing into, not 100%. So it's one of the investments that you should make. A very valid question, how do you decide where to invest, which sector, if at all you need to choose? Well, when you start, you should not look at investing into any sector specific. When you start, you should look at a diversified fund. Okay, the best thing that I would advocate you should do is invest into an index straight away. So there are funds which track the Nifty. Okay, so Nifty is the index of the National Stock Exchange. Nifty comprises of 50 companies. Okay, these 50 companies are all very large companies. They're established and they're basically market leaders in their own sectors. Now there are different sectors which represent in the Nifty itself. So when you invest in Nifty, you will be buying into banking because there are banks which are a part of the Nifty. You'll be buying into pharma companies. You'll be buying into capital goods. You'll be buying into FMCG, IT. You'll be buying into the entire basket of all these sectors which represent the Nifty. So as a new investor, a simple, a no-brainer, start investing in an index fund. So you'll get a basket of 50 stocks and it represents the economy as a whole.
You're watching NSE FinWiz Season 2. We'll continue after a short break. Stay tuned. Welcome back. You're watching NSE FinWiz Season 2. You know, students or at young age or even when they start earning, do you think they should really look at real estate as an option? Because real estate, I think, is a little ahead. Do you think it's more long term, or you know, when they have a lot of base, cash base with them?
See, well, real estate, the problem with real estate is that it is a very large ticket size. So assuming when you get into a job and you're drawing a salary of about a lakh rupees per month, the bank is willing to give you a loan which is equivalent to 50,000 rupees EMI, because they believe that is the maximum a person can pay. 50% can be set aside to pay for your EMI. So the qualification would be that you will be eligible for 50 lakhs worth of a loan. But this is the maximum limit. Now what happens? The problem with this is that If in case you choose a property which is worth 50 lakhs to invest into, 50% of your income is going to go into one asset class. You're left with virtually nothing in your hand to invest into any other asset class, which is equity, it could be debt, could be tax saving, you know, there's nothing else left. So what you could do at a young age when you start, real estate is an interesting place to be. We all aspire to own a house and to make a house of our own. You can go back tomorrow and say, I've built a house of my own, right? But you have to treat it like an investment. If your asset allocation permits you to invest 10,000 rupees per month into real estate, search for a property which is equivalent to 10,000 rupees. Need not be into metros. It could be in the tier 2, tier 3, or even go back to your native place and buy a property there. Treat it as a plain, simple investment. Don't let it suck out the entire liquidity that you have per month, because if you do that, then you have nothing left for anything else.
I just wanted to understand a little more about gold. I mean, gold is one asset class which isn't really productive. It doesn't add any more value on itself. All other asset classes like equity, debt, they actually make money. So why do you think people should invest in gold?
Well, it's a very valid point that you've made, that gold does not add value, unlike equity. Let me just make a small comparison and just substantiate your point. In equities, you would have possibly a company which is growing, issues, it issues dividends, it pays out dividends. Gold does not pay out any dividend as an asset class. There are possibilities of mergers and acquisitions which add value. Reliance Industries was one example which demerged into four entities, and they actually created wealth for all those four companies. So those kind of aspects you will not find into gold. Now, why you should invest into gold is that it is a hedge against inflation. It is a universal currency. Gold is a form of currency which can be used all across the world. It has appreciated in value and it is a store of wealth. However, it is not an as productive asset as we believe others are. That is why there is a restriction of investing. I said you invest a maximum of 10%. You do not cross and go overboard. In fact, in India, we have seen that we have, some kind of obsession with gold, specifically physical gold, when people want to have the touch and feel aspect. And we see that the investment in gold is one of the highest in the world. So while your question is absolutely correct, in reality, we see that it's actually the other way around. So sooner or later, people should start investing they should invest into gold, but restrict it to about 10%. In times of volatility, when the markets are, in the year 2008, gold was one asset class where everybody moved into, because that was a safe haven. That was a store of value. You could go and sell it and still get something which you had invested and above, maybe a little above that. So, but however, having, I substantiate to what you're saying, restrict your investment to 10% exactly for the reasons that you've highlighted.
Thank you very much for being here. I know you have a lot of questions, but we will be back soon again. Thank you very much. That was quite an interactive session we had with students at XLRI Jamshedpur. I'm sure they have a lot to take back home and they will be thinking investments soon after their first paycheck. It's time to say goodbye. We'll be back next week with another episode and with another set of young professionals. Thanks for watching.